Hey, I'm Nick Kalikas.
Welcome to the show where you get first look at the latest odds before they hit the sportsbooks.
And I'm Miguel Itturate.
This is the place for a unique look at MMA from a gambler's perspective.
And this is MMA Oddsbreaker.
Welcome to the show. Nick Kalikas alongside Miguel Itturate.
On today's show, we're going to get things started by taking a look back at last weekend's UFC 153, another dominant performance from Anderson Silva. We're also going to look at where the odds sit for UFC on Fuel TV 6, the card in China, headlined by Kung Lee and Rich Franklin.
In today's Oddsbreaker segment, I'll be joined by Damon Martin from MMA Weekly and Larry Pepe from Pro MMA Radio. Both guys will help me break four original odds that have not hit the sportsbooks yet.
So let's get started by having a look at UFC 153 from this past weekend. Again, Anderson Silva stepped up to 205 pounds, looked completely dominant in taking out Stefan Bonner. Give me your thoughts on that fight, Nick.
Man, it's impressive. He was kind of toying with Bonner from the rip. I was thinking to myself, he's asking to get caught. But man, Anderson is Anderson. He's very confident. He knows what he can do and what he can't do. And wow, I mean, how devastating is a guy? Pound for pound, the best for a reason. And it's hard to argue that the guy's not the best of all time.
He's definitely, you know, top two, as far as I'm concerned. Still, I give credit to Fedor Emelianenko for his previous run, but we're not talking about him now. We're talking about Anderson Silva. And what we saw this weekend was special stuff, you know. He gets put into the fight under circumstances that aren't perfect, you know, to save the show. He goes up a weight class. He's fighting a tough guy, a guy he wasn't prepared for, you know, preparing for, you know, with a full camp and that sort of stuff. And he still comes in, and he did exactly what he was supposed to do, what the UFC could only, you could only write a script that good, because he put on a show on top of everything else. He didn't fight safe. He didn't fight in such a way to squeak out a victory or anything. He fought big time, and he fought dominant, and he etched another long line on his legacy.
Yeah, I agree. And the closing odds for that fight ended up dropping all the way down to 900. So a lot of action, straight action, was coming in at the sportsbooks on Stefan Bonner. And, of course, the parlays were tied up with Anderson Silva. So they were pretty close overall on the fight as far as that goes. Some other notable fights here on the card from UFC 153. You have to talk about Glover's performance against Fabio. What are your quick thoughts?
You know, it was a bludgeoning fight for Fabio Maldonado. Glover Teixeira, he showed a killer instinct. You know, when you get a guy like that who can absorb a lot of punishment, and you got to beat on him for two rounds, and have the doctor stop it because the guy won't stop coming. Glover maybe needs to improve a little bit on his cardio, but he was putting out a lot of energy trying to take out a very difficult guy to take out. Maldonado deserves some credit for taking a beating. He got one shot in that maybe put Teixeira in trouble at the end of the first round, but I don't really think he's quite that level of fighter yet.
Hard to argue that, but I have to give a lot of respect for Fabio. The guy's a true warrior. He's a true fighter. I know technically he might have been outclassed there, but in the past I've seen a lot of guys want out of a fight for a lot less, and he wanted to keep going. So that's why he gets all my respect there. And Glover, I want to see him maybe get another fight or two before he gets a shot at Jon Jones, because I want to continue to see him rise and improve on some of the areas that he might need work on still. But let's go on to Phil Davis, man. He did what he had to do against Prado. I know a lot of people were really ragging on him for not going for the takedown in their first meeting. This time, he got the job done, went for the takedowns, and used the skill that he has to win that fight.
Yeah, I thought Phil Davis put on a very good performance. He fought a guy who was game and tough. The guy wanted to be there. I think he was a little happy to be there, and maybe Phil Davis showed him what winning in the UFC is all about. Hopefully, Prado will learn that for his future, because Phil Davis took him out with a very nice submission, played his game the whole time.
And also got to mention Jon Fitch and Erick Silva. Man, what a fight. It was a war. Both of the guys got fight of the night. Now, it's hard to argue that. I mean, the Fabio-Glover fight was an outstanding fight just from what we got to witness there. But Fitch and Silva brought it. Unfortunately for Silva, the cardio was the biggest issue, I think, there. He just got outclassed. Fitch had something left in the tank. I wasn't sure mentally, physically, how he was coming into that fight. So I actually favored Erick Silva, but didn't go that way. And you got to give all the credit to Jon Fitch. He's still at the top of the welterweight division.
You know, we haven't seen Jon Fitch perform in a long time, and I really went into this fight needing to see something big out of Jon Fitch, and I think we did get that from him. He deserves a lot of credit because he went from a guy who had very good power and control in many of his fights and was talked about as methodical to a guy who in this fight showed me that next level, which is a killer instinct, and showed me tools to take the guy out. He didn't get it done, but he was working on it, and it was a more aggressive fight, and it was a very overall pleasing fight, which Jon, you know, sometimes has not gotten credit for in the past. So I think he did take that next step, and I'm impressed with Fitch. I'd like to see him keep knocking away at the top contenders in that 170-pound division, see if somebody shakes up the championship. Fitch would be right in the picture.
Yeah, and make no mistake, Erick Silva's going to bounce back. He needs to get his cardio in check, a few improvements made, but he's going to win a lot of fights in the welterweight division. Another notable mention real quick, Damian Maia submits Rick Story in outstanding fashion, man. The guy, now, his win against Kim, a lot of people say was a fluke. His win against Story was just dominant.
Yeah, Maia belongs at 170. He did the weight cut right. He's energetic, powerful, and he's back playing his old game. He's a dangerous guy there.
Yeah, man, he's going to be scary for anybody to face at 170, I think. Maia's definitely legit in that weight class as well.
And you don't want to ignore Big Nog taking out Dave Herman in resounding fashion as well. Dave Herman really didn't show much. Big Nog coming off an injury. Dynamic and triumphant performance in his hometown. Way to go for the big guy.
Yeah, there's a lot of question marks coming in about Nog before that fight. And he came in with the belly at the weigh-ins, but he ended up performing well. And what about Dave Herman, man? The guy's getting worse. Is it me or is he not getting worse? Is that possible?
It's, you know, he came out with no game plan other than maybe to resist jiu-jitsu and talk smack, because he came out in a weird stance with his hand out. You know, it just, he never got off, and he's facing a slower, more methodical opponent. There's no excuse for that.
Yeah, Dave Herman probably, if the UFC keeps him around, we're only going to probably see him around for maybe one or two more fights. I'm expecting him next loss, he's probably out. So unfortunately for Herman, but Nogueira, it was nice to see a legend bounce back and get the win.
Before we head into the Odds Breaker segment, where Nick's going to break the odds for UFC on Fuel TV 6's main card, let's take a look at where the main event, Kung Lee and Rich Franklin, is right now at the books. Nick, get us up to date.
Well, an interesting scrap, and we did open the line here on the Odds Breaker show, so I urge you guys to go back and check out where the line opened. It was around 2.5 to 1, a little bit less. Right now, you're seeing the line at minus 275, the comeback plus 215 at betdsi.eu. So a little bit more action coming on Rich Franklin. And you know what? You kind of have to agree with it. I think Rich Franklin is the more overall complete fighter. Nothing's really changed since the line opened, other than the fact Kung Lee did get a little bit more respect back from his last fight, his win over Patrick Cote, which I was a little bit surprised to. He did end up going 3 strong rounds. Well, here's the change, though, a little bit. This is a 5-round fight, so even though Kung Lee was able to go 3 rounds in his last fight, I think he's going to struggle to go in round 4 and round 5 against Rich Franklin. It is going to be interesting because I expect these guys to be banging it on the feet, and Kung Lee on the feet is dangerous and he can hang with anybody, but it's all the intangibles, everything that you have to consider in going into this fight, and it should be Rich Franklin's fight to win or lose.
Yeah, I agree with you. Rich Franklin's not Patrick Cote. I think Rich Franklin is a far superior fighter, and he's going to know how to bring the action to Kung Lee and wear him out.
All right, time to get started on today's Odds Breaker segment. Let me introduce both of our guests. First, he's the lead writer for MMA Weekly and also the host of MMA Weekly Radio, Damon Martin. Damon, welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me, as always.
Also with us once again today is the host of Pro MMA Radio and the host of UFC on Fox Radio, Mr. Larry Pepe. Larry, welcome back to the show.
Great to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right, both of you guys are very familiar with how the show works, been on before, but for those out there that do not, let me quickly explain. BetDSI, our sponsored sportsbook, has donated a 5K bankroll to both guys. I've selected 4 fights today. The guys get to bet either $500 either on the favorite or the underdog. Now, the bonus fight does not apply with the bankroll, but we're going to get started today with UFC on Fuel TV 6. It takes place in China. You guys are going to help me fill out some of the rest of the main card fights. The first one's going to take place at light heavyweight between Stanislav, Nedkov, and Thiago Silva. Guys, Thiago Silva is going to come in as a decent favorite here. I'm going to open a minus 305. The comeback on Stanislav Nedkov is going to be plus 235. We're going to start off with Damon first. Damon, give me your pick and give me your bet.
I'm going with Thiago Silva in this fight. You know, Thiago is a guy that feasts on non-top 10 fighters. Anytime he's faced a top 10 light heavyweight, he's lost, but he feasts on the rest of that division. He just feasts on guys that are not really top 10 level guys. It continuously gets him in those big fights, but unfortunately doesn't do well in those big fights, but he really does well against these guys. Nedkov is also a smaller light heavyweight, which I think bodes well for Thiago Silva. He's a big, big light heavyweight, very powerful guy. If you saw Nedkov's fight with Luis Kane, you know, he wasn't doing very well in that fight and somehow came back and ended up beating Kane. But, you know, with the kind of power and the kind of, strikes that he's going to be putting on him, I just don't see a way he beats Thiago Silva.
All right, so Damon Martin is going to lay the juice. It's minus 305, so it's going to be $15.25 to win $500. Let's get Larry's thoughts. Larry, what do you think about this fight?
Yeah, I agree, and a couple of other reasons that strike me, that jump out at me in this fight. Damon mentioned that Nedkov was a smaller light heavyweight. I think he's a guy who's going to have a lot of trouble in this division as he goes up the ladder to better competition. Keep in mind that Luis Kane, who he did beat in that debut, had him in deep trouble but became way too passive and patient. Kane now a middleweight. I think ultimately that's where we'll see Nedkov in the future. But Thiago has all the advantages here. He's got a 4-inch reach advantage. Nedkov, heavily muscled and stocky. Guys like that usually have cardio problems. They're both Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belts. But Silva has lost to Rashad Evans, Lyoto Machida, and Alexander Gustafsson. He really, in those fights, it was length, evasiveness, and wrestling in Rashad's case that lost him in those fights. I don't see Nedkov having any of those things. Nedkov also has not fought in 15 months, so he could also come in with ring rust. I think it's a very tough spot for Nedkov. I think Silva wins this fight going away.
All right, so Larry's also going to lay the juice, $15.25 to win $500, and both of our experts do agree that Thiago Silva is going to end the undefeated streak of Nedkov. Moving on to the next fight from UFC Fuel TV 6, it's a battle at welterweight between Paulo Thiago and Dong Young Kim. Guys, another competitive match at welterweight. I'm going to open up Kim as the favorite here. We're going to start off with Larry first. Larry, I'm going to open up Kim a 2-1 favorite. Minus 200, the comeback on Thiago is going to be plus 150. Give me your take and give me your bet.
Yeah, you know, I debated on this one, so I think you did a good job setting the line. But ultimately, I went with Stun Gun Kim. You know, when I really look at Paulo Thiago, he came out with that big win over Josh Koscheck, which was really like a flash knockout. He beat a declining Mike Swick at the time when Swick was having all his health problems. Then he beat Jacob Volkman, who has since gone down to lightweight where he belongs, and most recently beat David Mitchell. His losses are to Fitch, Campman, Diego Sanchez, and C.R. Bahadazera. I think those guys are more typical of Stun Gun Kim than the guys that Paulo has beaten. When I look at Stun Gun Kim in this fight, I think the big advantage he has is the advantage that he's won most of his fights with. He's huge for 170 pounds. He has a reach advantage. And Thiago has struggled with bigger, stronger guys like Fitch, like Campman. And I also question how Thiago is going to be coming off the first knockout to CR in his last fight. A lot of guys don't respond to that well. So I give Kim the slight edge because I think ultimately he'll be able to get in close, use his judo, and control the fight on the ground.
Okay, a lot of good points made from Larry here on Kim. He's going to lay the juice. It's going to be $1,000 to win $500. Let's throw it over to Damon Martin. Damon, what do you think about this one?
You know, everything Larry said is right, but, you know, obviously the line on this one's a little closer, and it is a pretty tough matchup. So I'm picking the upset and going with Paulo Thiago based purely on the fact that I think that, you know, he does have the submission skill to give Dong Hyun Kim some trouble. You know, both guys have had, you know, some rough fights lately. You know, Kim with his knockout to Condit and then the weird situation with Damian Maia. Paulo Thiago, obviously, I mean, he would look like he was going to be the great next welterweight contender, and then he's lost his three out of his last four. So this is really a must-win for both guys. I'm really picking with my gut more than my head in this one because, you know, logic says Dong Hyun Kim will go for takedowns and basically just stifle Thiago on the ground, kind of the way Jon Fitch did. But I just feel like Thiago on his feet has enough power to keep Kim away, and if he can defend his takedowns well enough and catch him in a submission or defend him well enough to keep it on the feet, I don't think Kim has the stand-up. But, you know, again, this is really a toss-up fight, but I'm going to go with the upset. to say Paulo Thiago, just because I think he can do a little bit more on the ground, throw a few more submissions up, and probably win a decision.
Okay, so Damon is going to go with the dog value here at plus 150. It's going to be 500 to win 750 on Paulo Thiago in what should be an ultra-competitive fight at UFC on Fuel TV 6. Both of our experts split. All right, next fight from UFC Fuel TV 6. It's a competitive one at lightweight this time. It's got to be one of the trickiest lines I had to set to date for this card. Mac Danzig is going to open up minus 140. The comeback on Gomi is going to be plus 110. We're going to start off with Damon first. Damon, give me your thoughts and give me your bet.
I'm going to go with Mac Danzig in this fight. You know, listen, Takanori Gomi is seriously heavy-handed. Obviously, we know he has huge knockout power, but the last time Mac Danzig faced a, you know, really dangerous striker and lost was back in 2007 when he lost to Hayato Maksakurai in Pride, and that was obviously quite a few years ago. Since that time, you know, the guys that Mac has lost to have really been top lightweights. I mean, you look at Clay Guida, Jim Miller, Matt Wyman. These are really good, solid lightweights, and I just don't see Gomi being that guy. Gomi's biggest glaring weakness has been his ground game. I think Danzig has the takedowns and the wrestling to put him there. And then on the ground again, Gomi can survive, but I just don't think Gomi has the acumen to really survive for three rounds with Mac Danzig. So I'm going to go with Mac Danzig by submission in this fight.
Okay, so Damon is going to go with the slight favor here, minus 140, laying the juice. It's going to be 700 to win $500. Let's throw it over to Larry.
Yeah, look, if this fight happened 4 or 5 years ago, Gomi's probably minus 500. But unfortunately for fighters, when the decline happens, it tends to happen pretty quickly, and I think that's what's happened with Gomi. Yeah, if you look back at his record, 33-8 overall, you look at all those big wins, but really since he's gotten to the UFC, losses to Kenny Florian, Clay Guida, and Nate Diaz, and not close losses, dominant losses. Then when you look at his wins, Tyson Griffin and Mitsuoka at UFC 144, and Mitsuoka promptly went down to 145 after that fight and got finished in the first round by Nick Lentz. So these are not quality wins for Gomi. I think Danzig is much, much better than the two guys that Gomi has beaten. And really, there's only one path to victory for me in this fight for Gomi, and that, of course, is by knockout. Damon talked about his crazy power. I still think he has the power. I just don't get the sense that he's as well-rounded as he needs to be, that his cardio is where it needs to be. And the really bad news for him is that in 40 fights, Mac Danzig has been knocked out one time. And I don't think it's going to happen here. I think Danzig's submission game and his cardio will rule the day. I think he's looked really good in his last couple of fights, and I see him winning this fight pretty convincingly.
Okay, so Larry also agrees it's going to be minus 140, 700 to win $500 on Mac Danzig over Takanori Gomi at UFC Fuel TV 6. Okay, time for today's bonus fight on the Oddsbreaker segment. It's going to be a UFC flyweight title fight. Now, this fight has not been officially announced yet, but it is going to take place. It's between champion Demetrious Johnson and challenger John Dodson. Guys, I don't have to tell you what kind of outstanding fight this is going to be. We're going to start off with Larry first. We're going to break the odds. Demetrious Johnson minus 285. The comeback on John Dodson is going to be plus 215. Give me your take and give me your bet.
Well, listen, I agree with you. It's going to be an outstanding fight. I mean, it's being billed as the fastest fight in UFC history. Can't disagree with that. And look, to be honest with you, I think these guys are very evenly matched, except for one thing. I think Johnny Dodson has much greater knockout power than Demetrious Johnson does. Now, Demetrious, phenomenal defensive striking, very hard to hit, great wrestling, the speed, of course, and the cardio. I think the speed and cardio are going to be about even in this fight. DJ might be slightly faster, but 25 minutes in the cage and not getting caught with that power, to me, is what sways me towards Dodson, especially at these numbers. If you told me it was a pick'em, I'd have to debate about it. But if you tell me I'm going to get plus 215 on a guy who has 6 knockouts on his record, the majority of those taking place, 5 of those taking place above 125 pounds because he was fighting at 35 and 45. So I think it's going to be very difficult for DJ to get his hands on Dodson, just as it will be for Dodson. But the difference to me is that power. I think if Dodson shows any kind of significant takedown defense, then DJ's in a lot of trouble. And at these numbers, I'll go with the dog.
A lot of excellent points made by Larry here. He is going to go with the dog. 500 to win, 1,075 on John Dodson over Demetrious Johnson. Let's throw it over to Damon Martin. Damon, what do you think?
You know, I agree with Larry and a lot of points he said in this fight. I like John Dodson here. You know, the thing about John, if you were going to pinpoint some criticism he had before the UFC, it was unrealized potential. He was a guy that kind of lacked a little bit of a killer instinct, and I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that he was kind of toiling away without a right weight class, not really a good place to go. Now that he's in the UFC, however, this kid's got serious killer instincts. He's got nasty power in his hands. He's got a great body shot, which he'll tell you that's the reason he put away Jacir Da Silva were body shots. I tell you right now, I like the way this kid fights. Great takedown defense. Great team behind him at Team Jackson. And I just like stylistically the way that he can hurt Demetrious Johnson when Demetrious tries to jump in and pop shot him. I think he's got the speed and the power to put DJ down. So I'm going to go with John Dodson in this fight as well.
Okay, so Damon also finds value in John Dodson at plus 215 odds. 500 to win, 1,075. So both of our experts agree that John Dodson does have some value and could pull off the upset against Demetrious Johnson. Stay tuned for what Miguel and I have to say during our odds adjustment segment. All right, guys, fantastic job on today's Odds Breaker segment. You guys agreed on 3 out of 4 fights. Before we let you go, I do want to give you a chance to let everybody out there know where they can find you or what you got going on. Let's start off with Damon first.
I just want to say a big thank you for always having me on, and check me out on MMAWeekly.com every day, MMA Weekly Radio, and follow me on Twitter, at Damon Martin. Pretty easy to find me.
All right, good stuff. What about you, Larry?
Same here. Thanks for having me on. It's always a lot of fun to do this, and people can check me out at ProMMARadio.com and follow my Twitter, at Larry Pepe. Last name is P-E-P-E.
Okay, great job, guys, and looking forward to having you both back on down the road.
Well, we're back coming out of another hot Odds Breaker segment. Larry Pepe and Damon Martin are two special guests bringing the hardcore information to these numbers that Nick broke right here for you. Nick's going to go ahead and adjust these lines for you. I'm going to have Nick take us through that process.
Initially, when you do see a fresh line at a sports book, you'll see some movement early on when a max bet or two comes in. So we're going to take that same principle, same philosophy, and put it into play during our odds adjustment segment here. We're going to start off with the first fight. It was Thiago Silva versus Stanislav Nedkov from, again, UFC Fuel TV 6. Battle at light heavyweight. Both guys did come in on the favorite. They laid the juice minus 305. I'm going to adjust the line. Not too drastic, though, because I think with the undefeated record of Nedkov and some of the general public out there, he does have some power, and maybe Thiago Silva losing a little bit of respect. I don't want to go overboard and raise the line too much. So we're going to adjust the line. It's going to hit the sportsbooks at minus 315. The comeback on Nedkov is going to be plus 245 now. Give me your quick thoughts.
I think the line's right on. I think Thiago Silva is a higher skilled fighter. He's got a better level of competition. I think Nedkov, if there was a shred of wanting to go for the underdog, what he brings to the table is that gritty Eastern European hard-nosed attacking style where you basically got to kill the guy to stop him. And I think that's, you know, to his advantage. If he can somehow get Thiago Silva frustrated by not being, you know, by absorbing damage, by not being able to take him out, maybe he's got a puncher's chance.
Okay, let's go on to the next fight. UFC Fuel TV 6, again, Paulo Thiago versus Dong Young Kim. Now, interesting battle at welterweight. Both of the guys split on this fight, so I'm not going to adjust the line. It's going to hit the sportsbooks at minus 200, comeback plus 150. Give me your quick thoughts.
You know, Dong Young Kim, his last fight was a wash with Damian Maia. He got hurt. And this touches on something we talked about earlier in the show with Fabio Maldonado. I wonder if Fabio Maldonado would have quit in that fight. You know, and that's the kind of thing where you just really don't know. I'm not accusing Dong Young Kim of not having any heart, but what I see is that I want to see something this fight. I got to see something this fight. He's got to come up with a step-up performance, or there's always going to be that stigma around him.
Okay, let's move on to the next fight. Mac Danzig versus Takanori Gomi. Again, battle at lightweight from UFC Fuel TV 6. This is an interesting fight. Probably the hardest line I had to set out of the group. Now, of course, the line's competitive, but the thing is, we don't see Gomi the same as, and the public won't either, as we did a few years ago. So that's what makes this thing so interesting. The guy was one of the most fierce strikers in the lightweight division, but Mac Danzig's been on quite a roll here. Now, both of the guys came in and took Danzig at minus 140. I am going to have to adjust the line because I do think the public's going to agree with him. So it's going to come out at minus 155. The comeback's going to be plus 125 when it hits the books. Give me your quick thoughts.
You know, a couple of years back, Gomi was considered one of the top lightweights in the world, and it's not the case anymore. I think Larry Pepe touched on a lot of great points on exactly why that is. I think one other point on there is the psychology and the mentality of Takanori Gomi. He was the headliner for some of the biggest shows that went down half a decade ago in Japan and other places. And now he's just your run-of-the-mill lightweight trying to hang on to his UFC job. How does that affect you once you've been to the top? You see how hard in this case, you know, it's probably an impossibility for him to get back to the top. So what's he doing this for? It's got to play on him. I think the mindset of this fight, Danzig's heading upwards, Takanori's heading downwards, different trajectories.
I agree, but it's all about matchups, and I like the way kind of Gomi matches up, at least on the feet. I know that if Danzig gets a fight to the floor, he's probably going to submit Gomi. Gomi's going to have a chance to survive early on, but as the fight goes on, Danzig should end up getting this up. But early on, it's going to be interesting because the way they match up, I don't think Gomi's going to be easily taken to the floor. And on the feet, he's going to, even though he's looked questionable even lately on the feet, he's going to pick Danzig apart, I think. He's going to land some of the bombs. Both of them get hit a lot, but I think that Gomi has a great shot to do more damage and maybe end the fight. Both of the guys have stated how tough Danzig is to stop, but I think this formula, something tells me that Gomi can do it. He's capable of coming through, but if not, he's going to get subbed. So I see the fight going either way here. I'm basically on the fence with it right now, but I do think the public is going to side with Mac Danzig a little bit more so than not. Okay, let's move on to the UFC flyweight title fight, our bonus fight from today's Oddsbreaker segment. An awesome scrap. Anytime you got two of the world's best flyweights going at it, you know it's going to be a battle. I opened the line, Demetrious Johnson minus 285. The comeback on John Dodson was plus 215. Both of our experts did take the dog money. They believe that John Dodson does have better than a puncher's chance, so there was some value there. I'm going to have to adjust the line. The line's going to drop to minus 260 for Demetrious Johnson. The comeback now is going to be plus 200, so maybe some value still on John Dodson. Let's get Miguel's quick thoughts.
It's a good fight. I think this is the kind of fight that the UFC needs to break through and for it to actually match the expectations that people are going to have for it. I think it's going to be a high expectation fight. Dodson has his matrix moves and his big power. Demetrious, though, has been in some real tough wars and he's come through them real well. So I expect that Demetrious is going to bounce back with the betting public.
Yeah, it is going to be very interesting to see how the betting public takes this line and moves it, because the last two times, Demetrious Johnson really hasn't gotten a lot of love from the betting public, let's face it. Against Ian McCall, it was near pick 'em odds, but the public was on Ian McCall. Against Joseph Benavidez, a lot of people weren't expecting DJ to come through there, too. So he hasn't had the support from the betting public. I'm not sure if he's going to get it here. Again, John Dodson, the experts did take him. The betting public might agree there as well. I do think Demetrious Johnson is going to win this fight, though. I'm fairly confident. It's hard to bet 2.5-1 against the power of Dodson or the ability of Dodson, but I think Demetrious Johnson can win by decision. And I'm really strongly leaning that way, actually, as well.
Well, that's it for another episode of MMA Oddsbreakers. You can look for the odds that Nick broke right here on the show to start popping up at the sportbooks throughout the coming week. And a huge special thanks to our two guests, Larry Pepe and Damon Martin, as always, delivering the goods. Thanks, guys.
And make sure you guys check out our website, MMAOddsbreaker.com, if you haven't checked it out. We got a lot of cool gambling-related stuff, material content there for you guys to check out. Also, follow us on Twitter, at MMAOddsbreaker. For Miguel Odorati, I'm Nick Kalikas saying until next time, enjoy the fights.